thanks to the Keweenaw Convention and Visitors Bureau for supporting this video.
Hey there, I've got an exercise for you. Take a second and look around. Whatever space you're in right now, it runs on copper. It's in the device you're watching this on. It's in the wiring helping power the room or vehicle you're sitting in. Whether you realize it or not, copper is integral to your life, and that's not new. Throughout human history, copper has been used for everything from decorations to electronics. And recently, I got to see where some of that copper used to come from. This is the first episode in a series on the Quincy Copper Mine. It's a mine on Michigan's Keweenaw Peninsula that at one point supplied nearly half of the copper in the United States. These days, the mine isn't operational, but it is open for visitors. It's a registered Keweenaw Heritage Site with the Keweenaw National Historical Park, and there are both above and underground tours. It's a cool place.
Over the last year, I got to explore this area, and I went deep. I learned how people mined for copper in the 1800s, how to operate the giant machine that pulled up rock from the mine, and I even spent an afternoon underground, learning how ancient lava flows made all of this possible. I've been working on this project since last April, and I am really excited to take you along for the ride.
So, let's do it.
Some background for you. The Quincy Mine is on the east side of the Keweenaw Peninsula, close to the towns of Hancock and Houghton, and it's an old one. The first shaft was dug in 1848, which was less than 10 years after colonizers officially took the land and its minerals from the Ojibwa people, so they got on that fast. After that, the mine operated for just about a century, although there was some activity done after this point, especially in the reclamation world. The main activity at the mine was over by around 1945, so like the end of World War II. What drew me to this mine in particular, though, and part of what made me want to make this miniseries, was the fact that Quincy Mine was wildly successful, and because of a complete coincidence. Like, from 1856 to 1925, so not even the entire lifetime of the mine, Quincy produced 726 million pounds of copper. How big of a deal that was varied with the time period, but to give you some context, around the start of the American Civil War, Quincy was responsible for 45% of all copper being mined in the United States. To pull that off, the mine employed thousands of people throughout the years, mostly men and boys, and largely European immigrants from places like Cornwall, Finland, Italy, and Germany. And Quincy was also home to the longest mine shaft in the world at the time, which was about 1.2 miles deep and more than 9,000 feet long. So this mine was a big deal, both locally and nationally. And it was all because of some good luck.
Now, the first 10 years at the mine weren't actually that successful, but then they struck gold, figuratively. It just so happens that a huge vein of copper-rich rock called the Powabic Lode runs under this land. It's not like a solid river of copper or anything, but there is a lot of it. And this complete coincidence is what allowed Quincy to not just keep running, but to become so successful that it got the nickname Old Reliable. So this place is fascinating, and what I wanted to know was how they did it. How did they get copper out of the ground, and also, what were all of these buildings for? If you visit Quincy today, you'll notice that the grounds are full of ruins and relics, but I wanted to know what this place used to be like. Well, it turns out that the answer involves everything from sledgehammers to steampunk drills, so it's kind of a wild ride.
That said, maybe the first thing to know about working in the Quincy Mine was that it could be brutal. It could be hot down there, there were no proper bathrooms, and you could be doing some pretty intense manual labor for maybe 10 hours a day. If you were a miner, you were also working with heavy equipment and explosives, and in the 1850s, in the early days of the mine, your primary light source would have been a candle, potentially one stuck to your head with clay. Around this time, miners got copper out of the walls using a three-man operation. One person would hold a chisel against the rock of interest, and then the other two guys would swing sledgehammers at it. As if that weren't enough, when the hole was about 4 feet deep, they would then fill it with explosive powder to blast out a big piece of rock. Then they just had to get it to the surface. Early on, they did this by loading the rock into wheelbarrows, which somebody pushed up to the mine's entrance. There, the rock was loaded into iron buckets called kibbles and raised to the surface via crank and pulley systems called whims, which were operated by either people or animals like horses. Maybe thankfully for everyone, around the 1850s and 60s, the technology did start to change, and steam engines began to replace the manually powered WHIMS. With them came more buildings at the Quincy Mine, including hoist houses and boiler houses to make all of the steam, and you can still see the ruins of those buildings around the property. Now, the job definitely wasn't done once the rock came out of the ground, because there was still some heavy-duty processing to do. In the early days of the mine, people took that rock and heated it up in buildings called rock houses, and then some dudes smashed it with sledgehammers to break it into smaller pieces. After that, the rock without copper was largely discarded, and the rock with copper was sent off for further processing to be crushed into smaller pieces at stamp mills and then maybe smelted. Now, as time went on, the overall process didn't change that much. It was still all about pulling rock out of the ground, processing it, and getting the copper out of it. The big theme was that machines started replacing dudes with sledgehammers. And with machines, well, the story did get more interesting. As I was learning about all of this, there was one kind of technology that really jumped out at me. These things. They're called two-man drills and one-man drills, and they started to show up around the 1870s. These were big, hefty drills powered by compressed air, and they largely replaced the whole three-man sledgehammer system. This made mining more efficient, but, and you might have seen this coming, it also meant you needed fewer people in the mines, and if you're wondering if that caused labor conflicts, the answer is absolutely yes. There could be an entire film on this, but in particular, people hated the one-man drill, and in my opinion, for pretty good reason. With this drill, miners could work alone for 10 to 12 hours per day, which was not only mentally awful, but was also potentially unsafe. That said, the one-man drill never really went away, but let's just say people tried really hard to make that happen. After these drills showed up, mining went on at Quincy for decades, and the copper that came out of the mine went into everything from telephone and electrical wires all the way to uniform buttons and cannons. But for as successful as it was, it still didn't last forever. The mine sputtered a bit in the 1930s as copper prices fluctuated, but then came 1945. When the demand for copper dropped after World War II, well, the Quincy Mine officially stopped its main operation after nearly a century.
The world changed a lot in the time that the Quincy Mine was open, and it's changed a lot in the 75 years since it closed, too. If you're ever in the area, you can stop by and see the mine and take a tour. I really think they're pretty fascinating. Next week, I'll take you inside this building. It's the home of the Nordberg steam hoist, a giant machine that pulled up people and rock from more than a mile underground. It's the largest machine of its kind on Earth, and I kind of love it. For now, though, a huge thanks to the folks at the Keweenaw Convention and Visitors Bureau for supporting this series, and also to everyone who supports my work at patreon.com/AlexisDahl. I mean it when I say I couldn't do this without you. For now, thanks for joining me. I hope you learned something cool, and I'll see you next time.